Hi guys, and welcome to our third and last lesson for this quarter in our subject, creative writing. For our last lesson, we'll have reading and writing fiction. Here, we'll discuss about the following. First, the character. Second, the point of view. Third, the plot. Fourth, setting and atmosphere. And fifth, the theme and symbol. But before we start, please do remember the following. First, remove any obstacle that will hinder your study. 2. Begin with an open mind. 3. Write down notes. 4. Don't be afraid to write. And 5. Smile and carry on. Last time, we discussed about rhythm and rhyme, making music using sound devices, and diction and form. Best words, best order. Still under the second lesson that we've had, which is reading and writing poetry. And this time, we're going to change our focus from poetry to prose, particularly in fiction. So let's begin with the first topic, which is character. So a character is an imagined person who inhabits a story, but characters may also be based on real people whom the writer used as a model. Characters are not only limited to human beings, though. Some stories have the wind or death as characters. And characters are the first essential ingredient in any successful story. So, we really need to create a perfectly balanced character, something that is very well crafted in a manner that it is very real-like person. It is very, very much like a real person in a real world. So characters often possesses human personalities and qualities that are familiar to us and act in a reasonably consistent manner. It is important that characters are provided by the writer with motivation, which explains why they do the things they do. If for some reason, a character behaves in a sudden and unexpected way, which is inconsistent with his or her nature and personality or act without apparent reason, we expect the writer will soon reveal to us the reason for such unlikely behavior. So for example, in our favorite anime character and our favorite anime show. So our protagonist is someone who have this personality, who have this motivation. For example, Naruto, he wants to be the Hokage of his village, right? So whatever it is that he is striving to do on the whole series of Naruto, it is focused on that main goal. And if something happens that is somewhat not connected to that goal, we as the readers or we as the watchers of that story were expecting that there will be a big revelation why he did that. There could be an internal motive behind it, or there could be something that triggered that sudden change of behavior. So motivation is definitely a key something that plays a major role in how we are going to create our characters. Because the character's motivation is what defines what he is going to do in the future and what he can do to get those motivation or to get the goals that he have in his life or in his story. Now, these are the main types of characters that we can create. First are the stock characters. The characters in commercial fiction are usually stereotypes, and these are characters that require less detailed portrayal. We already know them well since they have dominant virtues and vices. And most writers attempt to create unique individuals who are multifaceted, just like the people we meet, and not the stereotypes. Characters must be solid, complex, and real to be believable. So as much as possible, we want to create characters that are believable or someone whom our readers can relate to, because that character itself is so much lifelike, okay? Next, we can also create a character which is the second type, or the hero or the heroines. So this is the hero or the good guy who opposes the evil in a story, or the villain in the story. So a hero for the male, heroine for the female. So the hero and the heroine are usually larger than life like those found in epics and swashbuckling tales, and they are often stronger or better than most human beings and possesses godlike traits and qualities. However, in most modern fiction, we have here hero and heroines who have those or who are not stronger and better than other people, or basically they are the anti-hero, which means they are only ordinary human being, but still they are the protagonist or they are the main characters of the story. We also have the protagonist itself. The protagonist is the older and much more neutral term than the hero. So this is the term that we are most familiar with, right? Because this is something that is being used since our grade school days. So a protagonist is the person whom the readers most closely identify, since the protagonist is the lead character. And the protagonist itself is someone who is, or we are going to look into the story. Sometimes it is the point of view of the protagonist whom we are looking into. And the protagonist is, of course, the opponent of the antagonist. So we also have our major and main characters. So these are called as the lead characters, and they are more complex than the minor characters. Although major and main characters are much more complex than the minor characters, it does not necessarily mean that minor characters are unimportant. Okay, so minor characters are still important to highlight the major characters themselves. So all of those characters are needed in a certain type of story to create a well and diverse story. Next is the foil, or the character that serves as a contrast to the major character, which is used in a certain story to, of course, highlight the particular quality of the main story. So a foil is used to highlight the good qualities and even the bad qualities of the main character, basically. So the foil is there to give emphasis to the main character. Next, we have the flat characters and round characters. So characters in short stories are often described as either round characters or flat characters. So flat characters are stock characters, or they are the stereotypes and require the barest of descriptions. And flat characters are those types of characters that we don't want to use as our lead characters, because they are just stereotypes. They are the barest of the minimum. They are the most weak type of characters, not in terms of the strength as a physical character, okay? So in a way of the characterization itself, flat characters is just that weak, okay? So what we want to use is the round characters. The round characters are those of the protagonist or the antagonist themselves. They are the more complex, and they are the ones who plays the major roles in a story. Next, we have the static and dynamic characters. So the static character is someone who have no basic character change to the stories of the story. So for example, this type of character, from the start of the story, he is this weak, pathetic, little human being. And in the end of the story, he is still that weak, pathetic human being. Then we can categorize that character as a static one. While on the other hand, a dynamic character may undergo sudden changes, but usually expected based on the events. So definitely, the dynamic character is someone who undergoes the proper characterization within the story itself. So yeah, those are the different types of characters that you can create in your short stories or in your different stories in the future. So let's proceed now for our writing tips. So first and foremost, according to Lagos Egri, the author of The Art of Dramatic Writing, a writer must know the three dimensions of the fictional character. The first one is the physical dimension, which refers to the physical dimensions such as the body type, the health, the clothing, and movement. So as we create our characters, we want to, as much as possible, create a personality sheet of that character, and later on your activity, you are going to write a personality sheet of that certain character that you are going to create. Because at the end of this lesson, you and your teammates are going to write your own short story. So yeah, you're going to create your own protagonist, antagonist, and different type of characters. Next, the sociological part of that person or that character, of course, here comes the name, the biographical details, the social and economical status, the race and ethnicity, and different factors that affect the sociological path or the sociological part of that certain character that you are going to create. And last is the psychological. If you have the physical, we have the sociological, of course, the psychological part of the character is very, very important, okay? So here comes the personality, the speech patterns, the attitude, the hobbies, the fears, the talents, those things, the worries and stress, because all of these things, the physical, the sociological, and the psychological, those are the things that will make your character complex, that will make your character a round character, and will make your character a dynamic character. Okay, next, let's now move on to the point of view. And point of view refers to the narrator in the story. So this is the vantage point from where readers observe the events of the story. So it is the writer's special angle of the vision and the eyes we look through as we read a particular story. And in a story itself, we can have one or multiple point of views in a certain short of story. And there are three main point of views. And here are the following of it. The first is the first person point of view, wherein we have the narrator as a participant in the action. And we use here the terms I or we. And the first person point of view, or the narrator itself, is either a major or minor character, and we see the things as he see it. Okay, so it makes the readers feel like the character is confidante, okay? It feels like he is the character himself. Next, we also have here as a limited in a sense that the reader can only know what the narrator tells. So if our first person point of view comes from a minor character, then our point of view will be much more narrower compared to the omnipresent point of view, which we will be discussing later. Second, we have the second person point of view. It is used to tell a story to another character with the word you, and it is mostly told in the future tense. This creates an effect similar to conversational anecdotes, and the writer or the reader may identify himself or herself as the person addressed by the writer. A writer uses this point of view to make the readers feel that they are part of the story and that they are characters themselves. And remember that it is hard to maintain the flow of a narrative using the second point person or the second person point of view, thus shifting into another person of into another point of views will definitely help you to shape up the story itself. So the second person point of view is something that will engage the readers into the story itself. However, it is very difficult to use, okay, because it is much more laborious compared to the first person and the last type of point of views, which is the third person. The third person point of view is the most common point of view and uses the pronoun he, she, and they. It employs a non-participant narrator who can usually move from place to place to describe action and report dialogue. The author takes on the role of the narrator, and the words I, you, and me only appear in dialogues. So the third person point of view can be classified into two more major types. These are the all-knowing and the limited points of view. This is what I'm telling you earlier, which is the omnipresent point of view or the omniscient point of view. It is the all-knowing point of view. So since the third person comes as the narrator is, or the author is the narrator, he knows what is happening inside the whole story because he is the author himself, right? So he knows what is happening on this character, he knows what is happening on the other character, and so on and so forth. So this type of point of view is the most common because this is one of the most easily to use, and this is one of the most it is one of the most convenient for writers to use and for us readers to read. Next, we also have the limited point of view. If the one is the all-knowing, of course, we also have the limited, which is the exact opposite of the all-knowing. So yeah, those are our various points of views, and let's proceed now to the writing tips on point of view. So remember to stick with your point of view. Yes, it is hard to stick on the second person point of view. That is the only exception, of course. If you want to use second person point of view, then I suggest to use another person point of view. But still, do not shift can do not shift as much as possible, particularly on third and first. If you want to use third person, then stick to it all throughout of the story to make things much more better. Okay, just to have that unity in the whole writing experience and to avoid confusion to your readers. Okay, next, the thoughts of a character and the way he or she speaks must echo the same tone, attitude, and vocabulary. Of course, we want things to be in a one way. Okay, what I'm trying to tell here is this: we want things to aim, or we have an aim to things, right? So if we're going to have a character who have thoughts and who speaks in a different tone or in different manner compared to what he is supposed to do, then that will complicate things, and that will definitely make confusion, right? So we need you to match the tone, the attitude, and the vocabulary to the character and the way he or she speaks, and his motivation or her motivation. Last is do not tell, instead show. Of course, this is the very essence of writing: do not tell but show. And it is the best to write suggestive dialogues or to make the character express his or her love through action. Do not say I love you, instead show how the character loves that person. Okay, so that is the second part of our lesson, and let's head on to the third one, which is the plot. Plot or plot structure is a sequence of events that has a beginning, a middle, and an end. It is a pattern of actions, events, and situation. Plot involves the sequence of events in a story, showing how time moves and is linked by patterns of cause and effect that lead to certain developments, which eventually bring out the resolution. Plot structure gives shape to the different parts of the story, just like the framing of a house or the skeleton of the body. So we have here the graphical representation of the development of a plot in a story. We will, of course, start with the introduction, wherein we will have the exposition, and then we are going to have the rising action until to the climax, then the falling action, and the resolution or denouement. So let's discuss each and every part of that plot, starting with the exposition. So exposition. In exposition, the writer introduces the character's situation and usually the time and place of the narrative. You can begin a story in medias res, or in middle of things. Your exposition signifies that you have chosen a particular opening more than any other. Next, we have the rising action, wherein we're going to have the conflict or the event, the situation or circumstance that will shake up a stable situation. It is the struggle between the two opposing forces in the story, and it propels the events of the story and raises the issues that must be resolved within the story. And the body of a story contains the conflict, where the rising action is built to introduce the complications that are either external or internal. So here is the external conflict, which arises between the character and an outside force. And we have three particular external conflict, namely the man against nature, the man against man, and the man against society. So when we say man against nature, this is our man or our leading character against nature itself. For example, a natural calamity. While in the man against man, the enemy of our protagonist could be the antagonist himself. While on the man against society, the enemy or the one who is against our protagonist is the whole society. Now, aside from the external conflict, we have the internal conflict, which is the man against himself. So, due to the term internal, the thing that is the man or our protagonist is fighting over with is himself. Okay, so it may be his low esteem, his hopelessness about the situation, and so on and so forth. Next is the climax and the falling action. The central moment of crisis in a plot is the climax. It is the point of the greatest tension, which initiates the falling action of the story. An effective climax depends on a quick reversal of the situation from an unexpected source, and modern short stories typically rely on climactic devices that are subtler than unexpected plot twists. Next is the resolution or denouement. So this is the final part of the plot, and this French term denouement refers to the untying of a knot, wherein in the final part, of course, we are expected to untie the knot or the conflict itself. So denouement makes the characters return to the stable situation. It is a moment of insight, discovery, or revelation, by which a character's life or view of life is greatly altered. A story's denouement may be closed or open. A closed denouement ties up everything neatly and explains all unanswered questions the reader might have, just like in many mystery or detective stories. So this is the most common type of ending, which is the closed one, which we have the happy ending or the tragic ending. While on the other hand, we have the open denouement. So this one is the open ending, and this is the ending, or this is the type of ending which is open for interpretation. So for our writing tips, please, in the beginning, you need to write an attention-getting narrative. It should be clear and interesting. Okay? You want to write the beginning as snappy as possible, as flashy as possible, to make your readers hooked into the story right from the beginning itself. Okay? Next, in the middle, you need to develop the characters. Make them dynamic, not static. Okay? Create connections to one another. And the tension must continue to rise from the beginning. Okay? There must this be gradual increase in the tension. And last, the end should be strong and satisfying. It must not be hurried and forced. The end should be something that will satisfy you as an author and your readers. Okay? If the readers really loved your story, they really want to have a satisfying ending, right? For example, that telenovela or Korean novela that you've been watching, if you are someone who is familiar with that type of movies or that type of TV shows, then you definitely want to have an ending to a character that you've really loved, something that he deserves or he or she deserves, right? So that should be the type of ending that you strive as well on your personal writing. So another writing tips, the flashback should reveal something important from the past, not just some random things from the past. A flashback should be used to tell what happened in the past that will greatly affect the future. Next, you should have the three questions. What does your character wants to achieve? This is his or her goal. What is at stake? This is what is going to be the risk. What is the risk of achieving that goal? And who or what gets in the way? This is the antagonist himself or herself. Next, the conflict. You need to set up challenging roadblocks and obstacles or a worthy antagonist. So we don't just want to have a great protagonist, we also want to have a great antagonist, because the great protagonist need to have a great antagonist, since they need to complement one another. They need to work together to make the story much more interesting compared to having a great protagonist but a bland antagonist. That will just make the story much more easier, and you know, there will be no thrill in the whole story itself. So another writing tips, the narrative devices. You should use irony and foreshadowing, of course, and the consequences. If there should be any consequences in the story, if the main character chose the wrong things in his actions, then the consequences must be grim and unsettling to make sure that the readers will have the same experience, that the readers will definitely know the gravity of what the main character had, or what the gravity of the main character's actions. So now, let's all remember once again that we are all accountable to do our best, even if it seems to be not as best as what we wanted. And also, we need to respect each other's work and try to help one another. Now for your activity, open a document entitled Q3 Lesson 3 _ Creative Writing _ Sir Michael _ Worksheet number 4. Here is your activity. So just like what I've told you earlier, you are going to create a character detail sheet. Here you are going to create your protagonist. You need to fill up all of those information to generally create a round character. And also, your antagonist, of course. After those, you just have to write a sample dialogue involving those two characters that you've just created, the antagonist and the protagonist, just a sample one, okay? So the A will be the protagonist and the B will be our antagonist. And also, you want to supply the necessary details to describe the following. The first, the country where the characters live. This is a part of characterization, okay? Number two, the region and city where the characters live. The three, house of the characters. And four, significant place on the story. So this is the setting building of the story. This will be another part of the atmosphere, which we are going to talk about in the next lesson video. And number four is decide on the following details. What is your draft title of the story? So I want you to create now the title of the story. So this is just a draft. Take note. So things might still change in the future, but I want you to have a brainstorming on this part, okay? And two, what will be the conflict all about? Of course, you need to have a conflict in order to have a motivation. And number three, what will be the central theme of the story? What is your story all about? So those are the things that you must do together with your group mates. So this is worksheet number four. And let's go back to the presentation. So yeah, that is the thing that you're going to do for today and for tomorrow for your ICL. And on next week, we will have our last lesson video for this quarter together with your performance task. So thank you guys for watching, and this is the end of our first part of lesson 3. See you guys next week. Goodbye.